closed their school and reconstituted it so they can reopen it, but do it under a different plan or have their ISD more involved. So the benefits of doing this partnership model is to put a broad spectrum of technical expertise and resources in the hands of a struggling school district, not just to label them as failing, but to bring partners to the table, including the state and several of the departments at the state, local businesses, as I said, nonprofits, colleges, and universities, to help shine that light on the problem and be part of the solution. It also provides districts a fair amount of time to get their plan in place and to see outcomes happen. The ultimate benefit, of course, is to the students to be in a school that is achieving at a higher level. So I want to thank the districts that are entered into those partnership agreements and thank the business community, nonprofits, colleges, and universities for stepping up to the plate and partnering. Second issue is ESSA. ESSA is Every Student Succeeds Act. It's the federal law that governs and replaces the No Child Left Behind Act. The goal behind it is to give each state more control over its education improvement and accountability systems. We're still waiting for our ESSA plan to be approved, so we'll see if that actually happens. Because the Michigan plan was designed based on Michigan input and by thousands of stakeholders saying what is best for Michigan and Michigan's children, not looking at federal mandates or federal requirements. Some of the new items in the ESSA plan as compared to No Child Left Behind will be a transparency dashboard, which will give parents clear understanding of where their child is performing. It will not only give the data for their own school, it will give it for a like school and for the state, and it'll have a search engine where people can say, how does my district compare to a district, and they can choose that district and run the comparison. It also will have a whole child focus, and that is one of the big changes, because we can't just simply say kids aren't doing well on test scores. We have to look at the whole child. What is the child bringing to them to school that we need to help resolve those issues so the child can focus on the academics? Number three, it's supportive, not punitive. We're not here to take a hammer or to say you're failing and to constantly label you as failing, but we're to say we want to form a partnership agreement with you to move this district forward and bring resources and people and partners to the table. Each school will be conducting a comprehensive needs assessment to study, look at their data, look at their resources, and say, where are we not meeting our goals, and what do we need to do to make improvements? And then they have to write a school improvement plan based on that. We also want to develop and respect our best educators. We have to prepare teachers in a different way to enter the field of education, and those who do enter it, we need to provide more support so that they can be successful. We'd also like to thank the W.K. Kellogg Foundation for the financial resources they've given us to help parent focus groups be put together, to help us write the ESSA plan, to help us with the transparency dashboard, and to make sure the parent voice is involved in the process. The third topic I was asked to speak on is Top 10 and 10. Top 10 and 10 is Michigan's plan to move us forward into a top 10 performing state. We know that we're not performing where we want to be, so what are the plans to get us there? Top 10 is centered around learner-centered support, what's taking place in the classroom, what we need to do differently, teacher prep, how we're preparing teachers for success, both new teachers and current teachers, and partnerships, how can we partner with business community, nonprofits, colleges, and universities to really give schools a chance to be successful. So what is it we want our students to be able to do? If we're not performing well, what is it we want our students to do? We want them to be problem solvers. We want them to work independently and in teams. We want them to maintain their curiosity. We want them to think deeper. We want them to be able to communicate verbally and in writing. We want them to be able to set and achieve goals. And we want to meet high academic standards. One of the things that I'm glad I did the state suit, but in some ways I wish I wouldn't have, is I raised the bar on what it meant to be successful. So the numbers you're hearing about the number of third and fourth graders and their proficiency level sounds really bad, but understand it's because I raised the bar. If I hadn't raised the bar, we'd be talking about 70 to 75% of the kids would be proficient, but they would be proficient at a low bar. So yes, I've raised the bar, and whenever you raise the bar, it takes 2 to 3 years for school districts and students to adjust to that higher bar. So yes, our numbers don't look good, but it's because we raised the bar. And when you compare yourself to other states, you're not really comparing apples to apples, because what is it each state is expecting their students to learn? Michigan has set a very high bar. So keep that in mind when you hear the numbers. So what does top 10 and 10 mean to school districts and to parents? We want school districts to provide multiple pathways for students. So for example, in an elementary school, we want a traditional elementary offering to parents, but then we also want a competency-based or project-based offerings where students don't go through grades, second grade, third grade, fourth grade. Instead, they go through competencies. And when they've met those competencies, they move on. We don't arbitrarily say you're in a certain grade based on your age. Instead, you move forward through the system based on the competencies that you have achieved. Or project-based, where students are working, as we said, individually and in teams to do projects to learn topics in a different way. Middle school, we want them to get more career counseling. We want them to have access to high school classes if they're ready for it. And we want alternatives like IB, International Baccalaureate type schools. High school options, we've had this debate. Should you go to CTE? Should you go to high school or college? Let's end those debates and let's create multiple pathways and let parents decide. So let's have a viable CTE offering. There are a lot of great jobs in technology and construction, welders, electricians, plumbers that can make good living. So let's support kids who want to do that. Let's support college offering programs, whether they be IB or five-year college offerings, where we pay for the first 2 years of college as part of their high school experience. Let's give students an opportunity to explore the career options in a meaningful way. And if they choose two or three options, how can they experience those business opportunities either during the school day or in the evening or during the summer so that they understand the choices they're making and then they can align their high school and college courses to the what they want to accomplish in their life. I like to ask students, what is a problem they want to solve? What are they passionate about? And how do we help create a system where they can have multiple pathways to achieve that? Other things top 10 means is having preschool for all 3 and 4 year olds. It means looking at the school calendar so that we don't have this long summer break and we get the summer loss that hurts a lot of students. And how can we change the classroom instruction to deeper learning if you're familiar with the Michael Follin work? The last thing I was asked to speak on is the third grade reading and what we're doing as a department to help districts be prepared for making sure every third grader is reading at a level. Now, part of me says that's not even realistic because we all know students develop at a different level and different pace. And while it's good to say how are kids doing at third grade, I disagree that we should be holding students back, but that is the law of the land. And so we'll see how that goes moving forward. But what are we doing to help school districts be successful? There's $6 million in grants to create literacy coaches so that ISDs and local districts have experts in literacy working with not only students but teachers. There's almost $21 million in grants for school districts to apply for to add in additional instructional time so students who need extra time are getting it, particularly before the third grade. There's $4 million in assessment reimbursement so that students are taking assessments, seeing how they're performing, and getting to the additional support that they need based on those assessments. The governor has invested $150 million of new dollars, additional increases in at-risk funding programs for students, so that's making a difference. And of course, the federal title programs, we're still waiting to see what the budget will be this over the next couple of years, but those also support early literacy programs. So that's my prepared remarks, and I look forward to being part of the panel. Thank you.
Taking notes, and I was trying to decide, man, if I write a story, there's like 6 stories there, so you know, read choppy to see which one we pick.
All right.
So we're here obviously to talk about poverty and racial equity and education, and I don't think there's anybody in this room who isn't aware of all the different ways that those issues intersect with each other and all the different ways that poverty and inequity are affecting everything from
student attendance, to, you know, classroom school resources, to ultimately student performance. So I think we should use as much of this time as humanly possible to focus on solutions. So I want to start out by asking each of the panelists, what are the programs that are working in Michigan, across the country? What are schools or districts or states doing that's actually really working, that's been proven to effectively help children who need the most help succeed in school and in life? I'm starting to kind of go this way.
So I've spent a fair amount of my career in the early childhood space, so of course my answer is going to be about early childhood care and education programs. But what I would say about that is that, and I would say over the course of the years in our state, I've seen a lot of demonizing of programs like Head Start and early Head Start, and not as much state-funded preschool, the GSRP program, and I think those are misguided criticisms, because what we know about those historic programs, and Head Start's 50 plus years now in existence, is that those programs started out as anti-poverty programs. And yes, they have an education component, but they also have components that deal with the needs of that entire family and the parents. And so that when we are investing in high quality early childhood care and education programs, we are in fact investing in programs that work. My asterisk there is that early childhood programs are not a silver bullet, because children exist within families and communities that have all sorts of challenges. And so, yes, we need a high quality, access to high quality early childhood, but we need lots of other things surrounding that to help chip away at this problem.
I wasn't gonna bend over a mic. I'm too old for that. So I want to say congratulations to everybody in the audience for coming to the very best session. So I would say a couple things. One is, I think that there are programs that work. We know that early childhood is an incredibly important function for poor families, but it's not just for poor families, it's for all families. The unfortunate reality is that in the state of Michigan, although we have increased some funding for GSRP, we have actually decreased pretty significantly child care subsidies. And so just basic high quality child care for children across the board is extraordinarily important, and we know that. The second thing I would say is that we also know that what's happening in our country, and it is particularly prevalent in the state of Michigan, is the opportunity gap. And that is programming and services that we all took for granted when we were in school. Things like music and arts and after school programs. In the state of Michigan, or across the country, honestly, rich families spend 8 times as much as poor families can spend on that. And even if you go into poor families, 60 to 70%, I mean into poor neighborhoods, 60 to 70% of those programming are actually still cost families. So what you find is that the things that would engage many young people and keep them attached to school are actually disappearing. And I'm not just saying that any programming, school, after school programs, extracurricular programs, enrichment programs have to be in alignment with high quality standards, just like a school building does as well. So when you have those high quality standards, then the programs actually translate pretty significantly in results. And we see that even in academic gains. So just one quick example about this is that research has shown that if young people go to a high quality after school program where there are caring adults around them, supporting them, encouraging them, exposing them to the practices that will help them be successful as adults and successful as students, that they actually do better in math by 40%. It is not better math instruction, it is not more math instruction. It is actually meeting the developmental needs of young people that make a difference. And then the last thing I would just say most home visitation programs, regardless, not just at the early level, but all the way throughout the school experience, throughout a K-12 experience matter. Those home visits actually translate into academic gains and developmental gains for all children at every single level.
I mean, I agree with what's been said. Childcare, we've invested more money this year in terms of reimbursement for childcare, and we know we're still way below where we need to be, but at least we've made some gains there. Early childhood, we've expanded those programs, and I'd like to continue to expand it so that any child, 3 or 4 year old, can have access to early childhood high quality programs. Extra instructional time has worked for district, whether that's done by districts or as a local SUP. I know I had a community partner access that provided before, after school and summer programs, and we saw what that did in terms of student gains. MTSS, multi-tiered systems of support, when done research-based, that is about meeting the needs of each student in the classroom, first as a classroom teacher and then as students need additional support, that coming from others as well. The whole child approach, trauma, we know that if we're gonna address the issue of making students more successful, we have to address that whole child. We have to understand kids who have gone through trauma, and we have to provide support. And we know the classroom teacher research says that's the number one indicator. So what are we doing to help teachers be more successful in the classroom? And quite frankly, what are we doing about preparing teachers who look like the students who they're educating? How can we get more teachers like that? Because I think it's easier, and the research shows that makes a difference.
Okay, now I want to ask the opposite question. So you guys all talk about what works, and I think we all know that in public policy, there's all these kind of trendy things that everybody's funding and saying, oh, we need to put our money behind this. And educators in the classroom are all shaking their heads saying, oh no, well, can't wait for this one to burn out. So what are the things that you're seeing right now that you, if you could wave a magic wand and vanish it, make it go away, and you don't all have to answer this, but if anyone wants to volunteer, what are the programs out there that we need to just stop having?
Well, I mean, I will say this, that when we went in and looked at our 9 partnership districts, the districts, 37 buildings that were about to close, what we did see is there was a lot of community partners who had brought in programs into the school, and the schools were in such dire shape, they just took any help that could come. And while that's appreciated, it sometimes worked against each other. And so we really need community partners who want to come in, whether those are foundations or businesses, really to say, I'm not going to come in with X program. I'm going to come in and sit down with the school district and say, what does the data say, and what are your goals, and what can we do to align to that? What resources, what people, what programs can we bring? So I don't want to sit here and list ones that aren't working, but I know that districts that are struggling are doing too much. And I would just encourage community partners that when they're working with a school to be laser-like focused and not bring the flavor of the month club in to solve the problem, but to be aligned to the goals and to the district.
My answer was going to be similar in the sense that not a specific program to stop, but trying to think about really coordinating efforts and not having kind of all of kind of duplicative and multiple programs in a setting and kind of not thinking about a strategy for moving forward as opposed to just picking the next thing that we think might work. And I would also say that I would like us to stop implementing programs that are aimed at fixing the kid as opposed to fixing the system and the context in which that kid is trying to thrive. Because that is in fact. And I would just say that I was thinking about as I was preparing for this, and because this is about race, poverty, and education, I was thinking about kind of the disparate impacts that lots of the kind of programs and things we try have on children of color in our state. And what would happen if before we implemented a new thing, we took a minute and said, what would be the impact on communities of color of this? For example, if we start holding kids back in 2019 who can't pass the third grade MSTEP, and we know disproportionately Black and brown children in our state can't pass the third grade of reading, are we going to think about the disparate impact that's going to have on our children when we start doing that? Perhaps that's not the thing we want to do. So it's less about specific programs, it's more about coordination of effort and trying to be thoughtful on the front end about how those programs impact poor children and children of color.
I would agree with much of what's said. I would say it in this way. I would say the first thing is that what we really should stop doing is standards without any developmental standards to go along with them. So high stakes standards, when we're not looking at the whole child development, is problematic. And so I think that we have to make investments in strong academic skills, but we also need to make sure that we're making investments in the developmental needs of children and preparing adults to be able to support them. And I see that across the board. I'll give you one quick example of this. I funded once a group of youth development providers, and many of them had been in the field for many years, 20 years, 30 years plus, and they had never gone through child development training before. And I see somebody over to my right who looks surprised, but in all honesty, there are many teachers who've never gone through child development training before. And when they started to understand the development of a child's brain, and they also began to understand what does trauma look like in children, they discovered that most of the children that they were dealing with every single day were highly activated. Now, that is an important understanding of how you deal with, how you practice, how you participate with young people as a result of that. But what they also discovered was that many of them live in these same neighborhoods that kids live in, and they're also highly activated. So you're basically putting two highly activated people in the room, and nothing good is going to come out of that. And so the reason that that comes forward is because we have under-appreciated and under-supported the need for whole child development. The second thing I would say about this, and I agree with our superintendent, coherence is king. We have to create coherence in school building. So we looked at all of the federal dollars that went to low performing schools to help reform them across the country, and we found that there were literally no impact that came out of those resources. I mean, there was just very few improvements academically that was expected or achieved. And I would say that it's not that the programs need to be defunded. What we need to do is ramp up our understanding of what we're trying to do when we fund these programs. You know, policy, intentionality, practice should be first, and then the resources should follow to be able to support them. And we don't do that, and we don't talk about it. We start with money first, and money is not the solution to the problems that we're seeing in our city, in our state, or in our country.
Money is not the solution, but it certainly doesn't hurt, right?
It's an enabler. Money is an enabler. It is not the solution.
Okay. Well, that actually is a good segue into the next question, which actually has to do with, so what are the changes that we need to make? I mean, you're all talking about really important steps that schools need to take, and some of them are things like better coordination and better intentionality, other programs, some of the social, emotional, some of the other, teacher recruiting, things like that does cost money. Money is not always evenly distributed. Lots of schools get lots more than lots of others. So what are the changes that you all would advocate for? State policy, federal policy, changes you would make either to our funding system, or to what laws would you like to see changed in the state
at the federal level, or what implementation changes would you want to see that would enable more of the programs that you all are talking about and advocating for, you know, make more of them possible? Tanya, you want to start?
Okay, yep, I do. So I would say a couple things. So as a person that said that money doesn't fix things, which I truly believe that, it is an enabler. And so I am not blind to the fact that we need more money, because Michigan in general is underfunding almost all of the key priorities that we know deliver results for kids. So for example, if you looked at the at states like New Jersey, Minnesota, South Dakota, Delaware, and Ohio, they spend between 27 to 38% more for low-income students than the state of Michigan does. So they have a differential funding formula in those states, and as a result, they are seeing stronger academic achievement for low-income students. In Michigan, we actually spend 97% of what we spend on all students in low-income districts. And so as a result of that, we're not seeing the kinds of gains. Now, there is lots of data out there that would suggest that there is a mixed result on whether or not if you spend money, will you get strong academic achievement? Well, it is mixed results, because you have to first start with policy and practice intentionality first, and then you finance that, and when you see people who follow that pattern, they usually get results. But the other thing I would just say, because I think this is really important, and it came out of a study out of Northwestern, is that if you just add additional resources for kids who are middle class in various states and their various communities, you don't get a differential impact in terms of academic achievement. However, you do if you do it with low-income children, and if you do it consistently over a 12-year period. If you do it consistently over a 12-year period, they're more likely to have two additional years of post-secondary education. They will earn 25% more in their lifetime than if they would not have had that investment. And then they're 20 times less likely to be poor as adults. So we actually could see income mobility if we were spending intentionally as an investment. And then the last thing I would say related to this, because I think it is two last things, because I think they're pretty important, is that one, in the state of Michigan, we all know that we've had some pretty significant demographic shifts. Our population is not the same as it was 15 or 20 years ago. We're an older community, but we have an overbuilt infrastructure, and we are not finding ways to help support that overbuilt infrastructure, to shrink and to support it. We're basically asking districts to figure it out, make all of the cuts that they can to figure out how to keep their budgets in balance. And of course, we want to be fiscally responsible, but if we only look at this kind of cut mentality without a significant investment, and also understanding the context in which we're working in as a state, we're basically spending more to do less and to do worse. And we see that, I think, in the outcomes that across the state, when you start to hear and see how we are sliding down the state national, the performance of states nationally when it comes to K-12. Last thing, and this really is the last, because I'm terrible at enumeration. But I drove up to Lansing, so y'all gotta hear what I gotta say. Last thing I would say is that we are totally underfunding special education.
Yes.
So we're underfunding it at the federal level, we're underfunding it at the state level. And we're requiring districts to basically come out of their general funds to really support students who have a diversity of needs. And that is coming at the cost of us not being able to fully use the resources we're getting to serve kids in our districts who may not have those special needs. It should not be this is not a dichotomy. We don't have to serve one well to serve in the other half. You know, it's not a zero-sum game. We can do both of them well. And I think the last thing related to this special education issue is that we have to figure out how we help, support, cajole, charter schools to make sure they're taking their fair share of students with special needs. Because otherwise, when you don't, and when you're in highly populated areas or areas that might be densely populated with charter schools, then what happens is that you have your traditional districts picking up not just the cost that they would have for their own student population, but they're catching those students because they become the kind of safety net for students with special needs, and they're not getting the additional resources from other students, which would make it a financially viable situation.
So you mentioned charter schools, and your question was about funding and where we need to spend money. I would like to see more investment in local school districts as opposed to charter schools and for-profit schools, because what we know to be true, even if people don't necessarily want to say it out loud, is that some of these schools that are, some of these charter schools and for-profit schools are producing worse outcomes for poor children and children of color than whatever was a district their parents thought they were making a better choice by leaving. And so as we kind of spend state money to support all those alternative educational choices for families, we end up kind of disinvesting in local school systems, whether it's in terms of the financial burden of serving kids with higher needs or and that's a problem. And I think that frankly, when we think about this intersection of race and socioeconomic status and education, that kind of the proliferation of educational experimentation on black and brown children who don't have, who live in poor neighborhoods, frankly, I think is criminal. We don't do that same kind of, well, let's see if this works, and let's put money here, as opposed to investing in the districts that, and yeah, some of these districts are not doing their job. So how about we figure out how to help those districts and put our funds into that, as opposed to into systems and schools that are not producing any better outcomes than the districts people are trying to flee from.
So I would just add that if I were king for a day, I would change the school calendar and the amount of time kids are in school to a longer school year and probably a year round with intercession breaks in between. I would focus on less testing. I would agree that funding isn't the answer in itself. As a local SOOP for seven straight years, I had to cut my budget, yet I was still able to raise student achievement and raise graduation rates. But with that said, we do need to look at how we fund our schools and provide a base foundation for every student, and then look at three categories: ELL students, special ed, and economically disadvantaged students, and make sure that they're funding at those groups at a higher level. The next issue is school boards. I think that properly electing school boards is important, and I am not advocating getting rid of that, but I do know that we need to do maybe a hybrid or something, because where we see a lot of struggling schools, we see a school board that is not effectively working with the administration to move the district forward. So I'd love to see some maybe school boards that are partially elected, partially appointed, or some kind of process to where we make sure the school boards are operating in alignment with the superintendents, and not just simply firing the superintendent because of a cheerleading coach or something else has gone wrong in a school district. I want to make sure every child has choice between multiple pathways, as I said. I'd love to see the traditional offerings along with the competency-based or project-based, and I want to make sure every student has opportunities to have art, music, and gym every day.
Great. Well, so I know there's going to be some time for questions from the audience, but just sort of one more question before we turn it over to all the folks in the room. When we talk about education and poverty and race, I think a lot of the focus and energy is appropriately on urban schools, but there's, poverty takes a lot of different shapes and forms, and throughout Michigan, there's poverty everywhere, suburban, rural, et cetera. So the question I want to ask all of you is whether, does it matter, do the same programs work in the city as in the as in rural areas or in the suburbs, or do we need to have different kinds of programs for different kinds of schools?
I mean, rural poverty is just as troublesome as, you know, urban poverty. It may mask itself in different ways, and in urban areas you have a larger number of students, and so you hear about it more, but poverty raises issues for kids no matter where they're at, which is why I think the school funding mechanism has to look at a base foundation and then look at those ELL special and economically disadvantaged so that we are funding them so that they can be successful. So I think poverty is an issue no matter where it is at.
It seems like, so I think that, yes, it's an issue no matter where it is, and it kind of, so whether I'm poor in Grand Rapids or poor in Sault Ste. Marie, transportation might still be an issue for me, but the solution, my transportation solution in an urban area might not be the same as in some rural areas. So it's less about whether or not the types of poverty are different, as opposed to the types of solutions might be different depending on the context for those families.
So I know the superintendent and also with Tanya Ellen, I think we're also advocating for, you mentioned a couple of different states that have funding models that have a base funding, and then you get supplemental funds for the percentage of kids in your school, the number of kids in your school who have special needs or English language learners or things like that. Are there any states, just really quickly, we can almost do the speed round before we go into the audience, but are there any states that come to mind that is Michigan, if Michigan were to change its system and adapt a different state system, you know, what one or two or three states would you put at the top of your list?
I mean, I don't know that anyone has the model that I outlined that I'm aware of, but there may be. I'm just not an expert on that. But I know that there are other states that invest more in education, but I don't want to just invest more. I want it to be specific, so I'm not sure.
So I would say Massachusetts. So if you look at Massachusetts 20 years ago, we were both of us were, our states were kind of both middle of the road in terms of academic achievement, and we both spent the same amount of money. Now we're, you know, in the lowest 10 states in the country, and they are at the top. And it is because they were very intentional about how they were spending money, the policy they were doing, aligning it, aligning very specifically to strong standards, and making sure that families who were low income or needed additional supports or in rural communities were getting more. So they now spend $5,000 more than the state of Michigan per child. And so when you start thinking about differentiated income based on need, you can look at places like, and I named some of them, New Jersey, Minnesota, South Dakota, Delaware, and Ohio. They all are spending in a different way than we are. And Minnesota actually looks at it that, like, if you have a school of children where it's 80% or more in poverty, then they get $3,000 more. And then if it's like, you know, 50% poverty, they may get a $1,500 more, but they're also putting, attaching to that some really strong standards and some really strong expectations that they're holding the adults accountable, not the children. And so what I think we do in Michigan is we tend to hold the children accountable, and we blame the children for their circumstances instead of thinking about what the possibilities are. And then we're also blaming adults too. I mean, in on average, we're pretty significantly below what we were spending. If you did inflation adjusted, we're pretty significantly below what we were spending in 1997, 98. And so we have to kind of look at that and own that and understand that context matters. And so the last thing I would just say about this, and Marietta just referenced it about urban and rural poverty, the content is the same. The context is differently. It's different. And I think in Michigan, we want to pull people's content from across the country and we want to slap it on like a third grade reading video that doesn't make any sense in the state without providing additional resources, but we don't want to add context. We have extraordinary large numbers of poor children in the state and they're getting poorer because we are not increasing the income and the wages, and we have a stagnation. It's actually decreasing for all of the families. So we have to think about how we put these solutions in effect in a different way, and we have to be creative and responsive and listen to the people who are actually most affected by it to craft the solutions. And